This is my fourth talk this week, and so I'm happy to be up here, and hopefully we'll do a great job, and then I can go have some fun, finally. All right, let's get started. So Jason and I are here to talk to you guys about securing the IAC supply chain. I'm Jesse, and I'm a senior principal software engineer here at Autodesk. And I'm currently working at the juncture of our security and compliance teams and our developer enablement team. And working right now on securing secure software best practices into our infrastructure as code tooling.
Hi, and I'm Jason. I work at Chainguard. At Chainguard, we help companies like Autodesk adopt supply chain best practices like signing and verifying using Sigstore.
And thank you for that, Jason. To understand a little bit more about why we're doing this work, I just want to quickly give you guys a little bit of context about Autodesk. We are a software engineering company building software for engineers. You could say that we make software for people who make things. We're a leader in design and make tools across a wide variety of industries, from entertainment to architecture and engineering to construction and manufacturing. Our customers and their workloads are pretty diverse. But they do have one thing in common. They depend on our software to do all of that building and making. And likewise, our product teams depend on our platforms to build and make that software. So with that in mind, let's level set first on some definitions, starting with infrastructure as code. Probably familiar to many of you, but what is it? First of all, it's code. So it's codifying the intent of a developer, good or bad. And as code, it's repeatable, diffable, and automatable. And second, it's usually executed in highly privileged environments, creating everything from networks to user accounts. You can think of it like the crew of the Starship Enterprise, where you snap your fingers like Picard and say, make it so. Common examples are Crossplane, Pulumi, and Terraform. But other cloud vendor-specific tooling exists as well. Next, software supply chain, which is very similar to what you would think in supply chains generally. It's all that upstream stuff that you use to build your product, right? In the software world, it's usually code, source, or compiled that you may or may not have had anything to do with in creating. There's a lot of code that runs in and around production that you didn't write. OS packages, language packages, Kubernetes, the OS running Kubernetes, your hypervisors, VMs, developer tools, build tools, your delivery system, your IAC, and its plugins, which is what we're going to talk about today. And increasingly, much of that software is open source, which means that you don't necessarily know who wrote it, you don't necessarily know if you can trust them, and how can you hold them accountable if they do bad stuff? All of this makes it a juicy target for attackers. So what is CloudOS, or our cloud deployment platform, we're kind of building this stuff into? 3 years ago, we had a strategy at Autodesk to reboot how we do our continuous delivery. And much of the early UX was informed by our previous homegrown CD and automation tool. And to ease the user's transition between these, an abstraction layer was built and to match that prior experience. Central to that abstraction is something that we call our ADF, our application definition file, which is essentially a declarative manifest of infra and app artifacts to be deployed. Our ADF starts its life as YAML, and then through our pipeline tooling built on Go and JSONnet, is turned into Spinnaker pipelines and Terraform, which in turn produce the cloud resources dependent upon by our products. But what of that Terraform, right? Where does it come from? Well, frequently it's created by our internal teams, but often they rely on open source providers, like those produced by HashiCorp and other folks. But how do we really know who produced those providers? What if they were produced by a bad actor? To be fair, it's not just Terraform that has this problem here. You see the Crossplane logo there. Almost all IAC tooling comes with some pluggable way to extend its functionality. And usually there are numerous community-contributed extensions. IAC is great, and it comes with all the benefits previously mentioned, but it does require a lot of permissions to do its job. It needs that power by design. But it's very important that it's secure. But whose job is it to make sure that that IAC and its dependencies are secure? Right? Well, this company that we won't name here is clear in its docs that they don't provide any controls to stop malicious actors, stop malicious providers or modules from exfiltrating your data. They don't say it explicitly, but there's also nothing stopping those providers or modules from, say, sending your credentials to some third party, or what about installing a backdoor in your environment with a provider specially crafted to install a command and control Lambda or through a container or VM image. We should note that Terraform does do some checking that the providers are not tampered with between the runs of your IAC. The log file, which can be checked into your SCM, stores the known hashes of the providers at the time of their first use, right? However, those hashes are not signatures. They are hashes, providing only integrity guarantees. In fact, the documentation makes it clear that they're providing no authenticity guarantee. We do not know the provenance of that provider at the time of that first run. There is a digital signature thumbprint that's output for providers that are pulled from a Terraform origin registry. However, they are trusted by default, simply by virtue of being in the registry. Terraform leaves it up to you to figure out whether or not you want to trust the signer, right? And it only does so after it has installed it. So how easy is it to publish a provider and gain that implicit trust across the entire ecosystem? Well, publishing a new provider or module just requires that you have a GitHub repo. Here you can see that someone has forked the official AWS provider and started publishing from a GitHub account that's named HashLCorp. How many of you actually know where this is going, right? It's pretty obvious. You see what happened? I'll let you look at it for a second. What protection do we have from typo squatting, right? You can see in the web GUI there is an official provider message, but how often do you use the web GUI to source your providers? I don't know. I haven't really been looking at that web GUI very much. Isn't it more likely that you copy and paste or reuse some code or follow a blog post somewhere and you end up with that stanza that you see there on the right? These are some usage statistics from some other provider fork inside the registry that's unmaintained, currently unmaintained AWS provider. Who's installing this unmaintained fork 14 times this week? Were they just confused? Here we see a module offered by the Department of Defense, or the supposed Department of Defense, right? And they're using the official AWS logo. How easy is it for a novice user to know whether or not Amazon actually has blessed this? And digging deeper, we see the DoD has quite a few modules. 75 as of now and counting. How can we be sure that this actually is the United States Pentagon behind these? Again, most IAC tooling suffers from this problem. You can see here that Crossplane community modules have a naming collision with the official Upbound modules. That may be by design right now, as Crossplane packages are currently curated by the community, but how long until that curation process can't scale and needs to be relaxed? So how do we defend against this? Well, currently a lot of mitigations rely on human behavior. We have mandates on repo usage, aka human enforced provenance. There's also version pinning and typo checking, but we know how fallible these can be, right? There's static analysis tools like Chekhov, Terrascan, and TFSec, but these are all based on block lists of known bad things. And we all know that block lists are a losing arms race. Just ask your local antivirus vendor. Finally, there are some tools out there doing dynamic analysis, which are either using sandboxing, in which case context matters. Whose AWS account are they using? And they also might allow that code to run in your account and then quickly clean up afterwards if that does some naughty things, but that might be your prod account, right? Like IACs used in GitOps, commit to prod, right? So what we need is allow lists, a walled garden approach. But unfortunately, as you saw earlier, the tooling leaves a lot to be wanted. It feels a little bit more like this than this. We want to create a closed ecosystem of approved IAC. And thankfully, Crossplane gets us pretty close. By centralizing the execution of our IAC and layering on Kubernetes RBAC, we can choose who has access to install managed providers. We can also choose what accounts and credentials those providers can access. But we still have the problem of enforcing that those providers were truly created by appropriate parties, right? How convenient that Crossplane chose OCI images as their package format. I'm going to pass it over to Jason to explain why.
So Crossplane chose to use OCI packages or OCI images as its package distribution mechanism, and this is really important. Sigstore is a project of the LF that aims to sign OCI images and many, many other things. I'm here to talk about Sigstore in one slide. Sigstore is a number of components. The first is Recore, which is a transparency log. It's public, verifiable. It's an append-only log of things that have been signed. Falcio is a identity and certificate service. It issues short-lived signing certificates in exchange, usually for OIDC credentials. You basically say to Falcio, here is proof that I have authed as Jason at Chainguard with Google. Please give me a certificate to that effect that I can use to sign some artifact. These two services are run as a free public good infrastructure. They were announced as being generally available yesterday. There's on-call support, defined SLAs, and you can run these yourself if you want to. Finally, the last component of the Sigstore bundle is this Cosign CLI. Cosign signs OCI images and stores the signatures alongside those images in the OCI registry. Not just OCI images, but Crossplane packages as well. You can use Cosign to attach and download other non-signature type things to container images, and you can sign and verify other non-container things, but we're not going to talk about those. We're going to focus on Crossplane packages. So I'm going to walk through very quickly the simplest and then a little more complex way to use Sigstore. The first is if you already have a public and private key, you can use those to sign a container image today. You simply take that private key, sign the image, and push it to the registry, push the signature to the registry alongside the image. And then to verify it, you distribute that public key securely to those people who might want to get it, and then also update it and make sure that it's securely updated to everybody. And that sort of falls apart. But that's why we have come up with keyless signing, which I think is really where Sigstore really shines. Instead of all that key distribution stuff, we rely on Falcio and Recore and identity providers you already trust to securely sign container images. Instead of having a long-lived public-private key pair, we rely on these identity providers. So instead of having a key, you first auth to some identity provider like Google or GitHub or Microsoft or others. This is the normal flow where you like do it, you know, pick your identity provider, and it just says, okay, you must be Jason. Go ahead. It sends back to Cosign an ID token that Cosign sends to Falcio. Remember, Falcio is this service that takes ID tokens and returns short-lived certificates. Cosign uses that short-lived certificate to sign the container image and pushes the signature alongside the image into the registry, and then also writes to Recore this public transparency log, hey, this thing was signed using this certificate generated from Falcio at this time. And so verification looks like just pulling out the image from the OCI registry. You don't have to talk to Google or GitHub or the identity provider. You don't have to talk to Falcio to verify. You pull out the image and the signature. There's enough information in the signature to verify that it came from Falcio, to verify who it was, to verify which identity provider was used to prove that that's who you were, and that is enough to verify that that container image was signed by your company's security team or your IAC team. You can also look it up in Recore to see when it was signed and in this public transparency log. This has been a vastly oversimplified overview of what we're talking about. All of that was in one slide, remember? So if you would like more information about how this actually works, like at the wire protocol level, there was a great talk yesterday from my colleagues, Zach and Jed, and a blog post accompanying it on our blog. But yeah, highly recommend looking out for that talk. So what does this mean for Crossplane, right? Crossplane packages, like I said, are already stored in OCI registries. This makes them a perfect candidate for using Cosign with them. You can actually Cosign sign these packages today with no changes. All we need was to implement verification of those inside Crossplane itself. So before it starts to run this package, it needs to verify that it came from a person with the right credentials in the right identity provider, et cetera. When you use keyful verification, you're only proving, was this package signed by someone holding the private key that corresponds to the public key that I'm holding? If that private key gets out and it leaks out, then there's not a lot of guarantee. And if your public key, if the private key was rotated and your public key hasn't rotated or vice versa, then you might be in trouble. With keyless verification, you can say, was this package signed by some person, some identity, according to a trusted identity provider like Google or GitHub? And is that verifiably recorded in a public transparency log? So that's really powerful. I'm going to toss it back to Jesse to do a demo.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, so as Jason mentioned, there's like two operating modes that, that Cosign can do its validation with. There's the keyless, and then there's the keyful. And you'll see here that we have an issue in the Crossplane project, number 3048, and a pull request 3360. And in those, you'll see that we have some dialogue about implementing the keyless strategy. Right now, we're just going with the keyful version because it was an easier barrier to entry. So at the top there, you can see starting Crossplane with this experimental feature flag called validation PEM. And we're just catting the key material from the public key directly into it. That's also going to change. Don't take this as the end design. We're probably going to have some other mechanism of loading keys from disk or from a KubeSecret or something like that. But for now, just as a validation of our proof of concept, this is the way that it goes. We're also adding the debug flag so we can tail the container logs a little bit later. Then you see us actually signing a package that I had previously published to a private registry that's actually a Crossplane configuration package. Both Crossplane provider packages and configuration packages use the package format, so we're just going to stick to configuration package to keep this brief. And you also see that we're using the private key pair to that public key to sign that package. And that, as Jason showed earlier, that signature is going to be stored right alongside that image inside the registry. And then you see here where you're actually using the Crossplane kubectl plugin to install that configuration into our cluster and create the CRD that will ask the Crossplane controller to reach out and grab this package that we're passing in. And here you see the tailed output from that Crossplane controller that's running in debug mode. And you know, it sees that configuration package install request, which comes in as a Crossplane CRD, and starts to attempt to reconcile it, right? I know that's a little bit garbled, but again, this is all a proof of concept right now. The pub key being used as output as a debug trace, that'll go away, but we're just validating that it got the right key. Finally, you see that the Cosign is being used here to actually do the signature validation with that key and the message that the package actually passed validation. And here you'll see us attempting to install an official Crossplane Helm provider package, right? That's being pulled directly from the Upbound marketplace registry. And clearly it hasn't been signed by my pub key. I didn't do any typo squatting on here. That wasn't me earlier either. As such, it fails validation. So ta-da, slideware demo done. Thank you. Some calls to action, right? This is why we're here. First, sign and validate your IaC if you can. You can use Cosign and Sigstore, which we love. But if not, you know, maybe GPG or some other tooling that you have. And depending on how your environment is set up, you can create your walled garden. Second, and this helps with that last one, centralize the execution of your IaC. Create that funnel, that choke point that will allow for the governance over who can do what inside your cloud environments. And third, know your IaC sources. Get that visibility, right? Make sure you have the telemetry either through your Git repos or your pipelines. That will give you some actionable insights. And after that, then maybe try some of the static and dynamic analysis tools like Divi or Orca. They will give you some pre-deploy hints and that, you know, what the IAC might be doing. You know, deal with the false positives and negatives, but it's better than nothing. And of course, try to run least privilege, right? I mean, I know it's hard, especially for new products or greenfield development, but maybe once you have some stability in your solution, you can start to ratchet down those permissions for future releases. Thank you. So again, I don't see anyone who's assisting, but we did plan a little bit of time for questions. I don't know if we have a microphone or anything. You can just yell. If not, just come up and talk to us afterwards. That's
good too. Yeah, we'll be around. Great. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.